It's the mid-1930s and the world is bracing for a new global conflict. Despite years of attempts at ensuring world peace through the League of Nations, diplomacy seems to have failed around the world and militaries once more prepare for war. Yet many nations still remember the historical cataclysm that was World War I, and are fearful of the death toll of a new war in the mechanized age. Others like Japan look at the staggering death tolls and years of trench war fighting as a warning. The small island nation is modern and industrialized, but it lacks the manpower and resources to wage a long, costly war against a major power. All around the world, scientists race to discover the next ultimate weapon, a device that can either defeat one's enemies or defend oneself with such killing power that war would be undesirable. For Japan, they thought that that weapon would be the Kugo Death Ray weapon. Japan in the mid-1930s had great ambitions to become the next global superpower. The first phase of its plan is already underway, with its troops occupying Manchuria where they have set up a puppet government that's beholden to Japan. In exchange for Japan's protection, the government of Manchuria exports to the Japanese vast quantities of natural resources that the nation lacks. Yet Japan knows that in order to secure its role as a global superpower, it must first seize the rich farmlands of southern China, and then deal with America across the Pacific. Its ambitions are grand, especially for such a small island nation, and success rides on a knife's edge, as the country will never be able to afford a protracted conflict against the industrialized might of the United States. A weapon is needed, something so devastating that the Americans will never dare to disrupt their plans in Asia. Years earlier, Nikola Tesla approached the League of Nations with a proposed superweapon, an electromagnetic weapon so devastating that it could knock 1,000 planes out of the sky at a range of 200 miles. Such a weapon would give the side that wielded an insurmountable advantage, and interest quickly grew around Tesla's plans. But Tesla didn't wish to construct these weapons for conquest, but rather for peace. Given their incredible size and the huge amounts of power needed to generate 60 million volts of electricity, Tesla knew that these weapons would not be mobile and saw this as a purely defensive weapon. Such a powerful defensive weapon, Tesla figured, would make war completely impossible. Yet, despite initial interest, no nation thought it was possible to generate the electricity needed to power the weapon, and thus the idea was disregarded by nations around the world. The seed of the idea, however, was quickly investigated, and Britain's attempts to make a death ray would lead to the development of radar, itself a superweapon which gave Britain a huge advantage intercepting German planes and in naval battles against German ships during the war. Japanese agents inside the United States learned of Tesla's superweapon and passed the plans along to Japan, where interest quickly grew among the military. Preparing for major offenses across the Pacific and knowing that the United States stood between victory and defeat, General Yamamoto was looking for a weapon that would give Japan an edge over the US, and he thought he found it with Tesla's death ray. Yamamoto would tap Japanese physicist Yoji Ito, a leading mind of his time, who, along with two other physicists Masako Tani and Sen-Ichiro Tomonaga, carefully pored over Tesla's plans and came to the same conclusion as the United States. It was impossible to generate the electricity needed to power the superweapon. But while Tesla's electricity weapon was impossible, it did get the Japanese thinking along the lines of building electromagnetic weapons. They turned their ongoing research into magnetrons, which were being developed at the time as part of their own research into radar, and planned to develop a much larger, more powerful magnetron. The device would emit high-powered beams of very short radio waves, which would be capable of causing intense psychological or even physiological harm to soldiers in the beam's path. It was possible even that the beam could make internal combustion engines stop, making it powerful enough to stop everything from tanks to airplanes in their tracks. With promising initial results, the Japanese invested heavily into the project, and it was put under the control of General Sueyoshi Kusaba, based in a brand new laboratory established at Shimada, Shizuoka Prefecture. The weapon's code name would be Kugo. The Japanese immediately began testing radio waves on animals, as well as car and airplane engines. The first experiments performed on mice, rabbits, groundhogs, and monkeys showed that waves with a range of 78.74 inches to 22.63 inches could cause lung bleeding and destroy brain cells. If it worked on small animals, the Japanese were sure it would work on human beings. Tests on internal combustion engines were largely failures, however, and while the beam could indeed stop an exposed car engine, it could not do so if the engine was well protected, or simply under a hood. The beam was even less effective against well-protected aircraft engines, and dreams of shooting down American aircraft with radio waves were dashed. Plowing ahead with the research, though, the Japanese looked to the beam's effect on living organisms as signs that the weapon could at least work against living targets. They built a prototype in 1944 consisting of an 80-centimeter magnetron, powered by 30 kilowatts, feeding a dipole antenna at the bottom of a 1-meter ellipsoid reflector. The oversized beam was first tested on a rabbit, which was placed in a cage 98 feet away. The beam was powered up and the rabbit zapped, but it took 10 minutes to die from the microwaves. Next, they put a groundhog in the cage, and this time the groundhog took 20 minutes to drop dead. Due to war difficulties, Japanese attempts to test the beam on a monkey were unsuccessful, as they couldn't get their hands on a monkey at the time. Despite the lackluster performance of the death ray, the Japanese developed plans to seriously upscale the weapon by building a new ray powered by 4 magnetrons with an output of 250 to 300 kilowatts. The project's physicists estimated that this new weapon would take 10 minutes to kill a rabbit at a distance of 0.6 miles. This meant that at much shorter ranges, the weapon could be lethal in minutes. And while it was certainly no death ray, it could still have potential if used as a defensive weapon against American landings. By this time, though, Japan's empire was crumbling under the incessant American assault, and research on the death ray was abandoned. Today, death ray weapons are at last being made a reality, though not in the overpowering and war-ending way that Tesla or the Japanese had envisioned. Instead of death rays capable of destroying entire armies in one fell swoop, nations around the world are developing high-intensity lasers, which are already proving their effectiveness in everything from ballistic missile defense to destroying small boats. The US Navy has several ships outfitted with a powerful laser weapon that can shoot drones out of the sky and incinerate fleets of swarming suicide boats. While a new push for ballistic missile defense has seen the United States develop everything from airborne laser systems to satellite-mounted particle beam weapons, both of which are capable of destroying a ballistic missile from hundreds, maybe even thousands of miles away. In the end, the quest for the ultimate death ray was an impractical one. But modern laser and directed energy weapons do offer some of the capabilities that Tesla had dreamt about. With their ability to strike targets at or near the speed of light, these new death rays are proving that they might actually provide the long elusive goal of effective ballistic missile defense. And so, while they may not eliminate war altogether as Tesla had hoped, perhaps the US's ballistic missile defense shield could at last give us a world where nuclear war is both impractical and impossible. Do you think a true death ray weapon could ever be built? Let us know in the comments. And as always, if you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe for more great content.